On the podcast today, we are going to speak about the magical powers attained through spiritual practice known as siddhis. And we find these throughout all of the three great traditions of the East. We find it in Buddhism, Hinduism, and in Taoism. But we will speak about it today primarily through the Hindu lens, because there is a precise template and framework in particularly Tantra that we find, where we have 8/9 great magical powers and 6 black magical powers. And we find these within 4 great texts within India, which is the Yoga Shika Upanishad and the Yoga Bija, the Yoga Bhashya, and the Yoga Sutras. And so we have this, and people have probably heard about siddhis before. And today, Guyang and I are going to speak about some wacky and wild stuff, especially in relation to the great magical powers and the black magical powers. But before we get into that, we want you guys to suspend your judgment a little bit throughout this podcast, because people usually fall into two schools of thought. Some people run away with their imagination a little bit in regards to siddhis, and they're usually new agey people. And then there are those who
don't believe it at all
and are overly skeptical. And we are kind of looking for some sort of middle ground today. Yes. And Guyang and I aren't really going to overlay our own personal opinions into siddhis. We're just going to present the knowledge as it is, and you guys can take it for what it is. And also, towards the end of the podcast, we'll also explain why the great master said we should avoid siddhis, mm-hmm. and how they can be problematic, and why actually we need to transcend them. And a lot of people get angry about that, who actually love siddhis and love magical powers, because they think, oh, that is what spirituality is about. And it's like, well, not really. So before we get into that, we kind of need a thorough examination of what the Sanskrit word siddhi actually is.
Yeah, so definition of siddhi is like attainment, accomplishment, and perfection, power, realization, mm-hmm. or like success in a sense of liberation, or attaining magical powers, obviously.
Yes. So it's not just magical powers, right? Like, that's where a lot of people get it wrong. They think siddhis means this. And it's like, well, siddhis actually, it's a Sanskrit noun which can mean a lot of different things.
Yes.
But in regards to spiritual practice, these are usually the magical powers or paranormal abilities attained through rigorous spiritual practice. Yes. And so you and I have lived a long time in Asia. Well, you were born in Asia, but a long time in India specifically. So we've been around, you know, siddhas and people who apparently have attained some sort of magical power.
Yeah.
And many people are probably familiar with the levitating yogis, and whether you believe that or not, and people who manifest things out of thin air. And so, you know, we will probably explain a lot more in detail today.
And also teleportation as well.
Teleportation, yeah, just like a lot of things like that, right? And people are probably familiar with, like, they might have seen images in Myanmar where the Buddhist monks will be sitting in boiling oil. In a big wok of boiling oil.
Yep.
And when you actually go there, and there's actually no, people are dumbfounded because there's no real logical reason why they can be sitting in that, because people check the pans beforehand, and so make of that what you will, right?
Yes.
So.
Yes.
So let's get into it. So as I said, we will explain this from especially the tantric perspective. Mm-hmm. And Tantra is not just about siddhis as well. And Tantra obviously isn't about sex, as a lot of people mistaken. So, but in saying that, Tantrism does have a concern about siddhis as opposed to Vedanta, right? Vedanta is...
Yeah, very critical of this ability. Yeah. Yeah, they're trying to dismiss this ability.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And that's two different perspectives, right? Like, as Vedanta, I wouldn't say that they negate the physical world. Like, there's an understanding of what the physical world is, but it's still all Maya, right?
Yes.
So, where Tantrism, mm-hmm. they affirm the physical world.
Yes, yes.
That's the difference.
Yeah, again, Tantra itself is, I think, the alchemical response due to your rigorous spiritual practice.
Yep.
That's simply what it is. But I mean, everyone is different, so people take Tantra different ways, and people use this alchemical response in different ways, different for different reasons as well, right? Mm-hmm. So in the end, nevertheless, like you said, Tantra affirms a phenomenal world that is for sure, right? Mm-hmm. So this manipulating a physical world, and it can be an advantage to reach spiritual goals, but as we know here, we're talking about this magical power, right?
Yeah.
So people use this in order to attain these magical powers.
Yes, exactly. So Tantra basically it's a positive relationship with cultivating this innate psycho-spiritual potential that we all have within the body-mind complex.
Mm.
And a lot of other practice. I mean, you could also lump Taoism into that perspective as well, right? They have a positive perspective also of the physical world and sort of cultivating that innate psycho-spiritual nature that we have.
Yes.
And so, unfortunately, Tantra, when it went to the West, it got lumped in with sex and became a thing about sexual alchemy, which is actually, to Indians, it's a bit bonkers, but to a Westerner, they think that it makes sense. So in relation to the great magical powers as opposed to the black magical powers, we have to talk about this two branches of Tantrism, right?
Yeah, so there are two types of siddhis in the Yoga Shika Upanishad.
Yeah.
That's what, this is from this Yoga Shika Upanishad. So it says, first one is a Kalpita, which is artificial, the induced magical powers from taking like herbs or some sort of liquid or some induced magical powers.
Yeah.
And the other is akalpita, which is non-artificial, more like a self-reliance.
Mm.
So you get to attain this magical power from your rigorous spiritual sadhana.
Yeah. Mm. So it's more of a naturally arising.
Yes.
Akalpita, right? Like.
So you could also say this spiritual power is akalpita is a byproduct of sadhana, could say.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, that's what they talk about actually in Tantra. They talk about steps on the path when you notice certain siddhis develop. It's like, there's a beautiful way to say it, like it's you're on your goal or on your way to Banaras or Varanasi.
Yeah.
You're one step at a time. These are like landmarks on your step towards ultimate liberation, Shiva. They use Varanasi or Banaras as kind of a physical manifestation of that, or representation of that, sorry. And these two types of siddhis, as I was alluding to before, was they related to two sort of branches of Tantrism as well. There's lower Tantrism and higher Tantrism. So lower Tantrism is kind of a less noble path, which is related to, obviously, the black magical powers.
Yes.
So unsavory practices associated with controlling or, harming others, basically. And actually, when people think of siddhis, they kind of think of it in the kind of the black magical way, using black magic, because a lot of people in this respect don't have their heads screwed on when they talk about this. But then there's the higher Tantrism, which is motivated by spiritual liberation, spiritual upliftment of others, which is completely different. So, and ultimately, in saying that, Tantra is focused on spiritual liberation. That it's just different in the process of how to get there as opposed to Advaita Vedanta, right? So,
yes.
So, like you were saying, so that's, but then you have these two different paths of lower Tantrism and higher Tantrism. So, obviously, you want to resonate with the higher Tantric order, and you're, as you were saying, with Kalpita and Alkalpita, is that we need to have more. If siddhis are going to arise, they should arise naturally and not through herbal concoctions and mantra recitations.
Yes,
So, just to clarify that, like, there are those different ones with Kalpita, like we mentioned, herbal concoctions, mantra recitations, there's rituals and there's alchemical elixirs and there's all of these things that can somehow invoke this these siddhis. But, we'll get more into that. So before we get into that, I mentioned the Mahasiddhas, right? The great adepts.
Yes.
The Mahasiddhas. So, and they usually had access to what we call the Mahasiddhis.
Mm-hmm.
And this is what the eight great, or 8/9 great magical powers, yes, are. And we find these in the Yoga Bhashya. And they're actually called the Ashtasiddhi. So the eight great perfections. We have 9 here because one is called Garima, which is kind of added within the 8.
Mm.
It's not commonly considered, but we were just going to briefly mention it. So the Ashtasiddhas are usually the 8 great perfections.
Mm.
And so, or the 8 great, yeah, the 8 great perfections or the 8 great powers. And so, and this is what the Mahasiddhas usually have access to. So without further ado, let's get into the first one.
Yeah, so the first one is called Anima.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. So it's a miniaturization ability to reduce one size to the size of an atom.
Right? Yes. And atom is very important in Hinduism. You hear it mentioned a lot, even before quantum physics.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and that's in Sanskrit, it's called the Anu.
Yep.
It's called the Anu. So we see Anu within a lot of the scriptures. We see it in the Yoga Bhashya, obviously. And so the miniaturization, this is kind of like when you think about this one, you think of Ant-Man in Marvel Comics.
Exactly.
They're taking it straight from the scriptures.
Yeah, Marvel Comics or just cartoons in general, they use this kind of imagination through, I don't know if they got the idea from these things, but yeah, it's all there, yeah.
So the second one is Mahima, magnification. So this is the ability to expand to an infinitely large size.
Yes.
So, and when you think of this, they say that if you have access to Mahima, you can be the size of a mountain or even a continent, they say.
Mm.
But you need to think about it in different terms. So in the Maniprabha text, they say that we're not really talking about the physical body here. We're talking about the subtle body or mind.
Yes. And so rather you kind of imagine your consciousness to be like a mountain or a continent.
Or it becomes that.
Becomes that. Mm.
Mm. You become the consciousness of that.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, to say that if a continent has consciousness, but you become that, the consciousness of that continent, it's difficult to explain, right? But you become sort of that because, you know, in real terms, Earth, for example, has a state of consciousness.
Yes,
it's beyond our scope of understanding because we're just a pesky little human. But but the planet has a state of consciousness, and we are just a little fragment of that. Okay, so, and then the number 3?
Is called Garima, which means becoming infinitely heavy.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And this one is interesting. This is like the one that we sort of added in because it is spoken about. It's actually not mentioned in the Yoga Bhashya, but when we think of Garima, if you remember, you know those, you hear the stories about, and you know, you've probably, some people may have seen public displays of this, where the Kung Fu master will sit there in meditation and he'll tell the students to try and move him.
Mm.
That's accessing Garima. They can't move him because he's become as heavy like as a mountain.
Yep.
He's actually, which is actually related to magnification as well, yes. Mahima.
Mm.
So he or she has become as heavy as a mountain. They can't, and they're like, how come I'm kicking him in the head and he doesn't move? Like, it's like hitting steel.
Mm.
But this is Garima. This is infinitely heavy. This is the immovable object.
Yeah.
So number 4 is Lagima, which is weightlessness and levitation.
Yes, well, that's...
speaks for itself.
Yeah, very common idea of siddhis and levitating yogis in the Himalayas or something like that. Yeah.
We have an individual here in Brisbane who goes to the main mall here in the city. But it's a trick, right? Like, because there's a stick there, they have the pipe under here, and there's a seat in their costume. Some people don't understand what's going on, but they're levitating.
He does pretty good tricks. Yeah, like, yeah. Like he looks like he make it look like he's doing some sort of reciting spell or something, right? Yeah. And then we've seen some people like, oh my god, how does he do it?
Yeah.
How they like, and then we're just standing behind, we're like, oh.
We know what's going on. Yeah. The theatrics he does, it is really cool.
Yeah.
But in all fairness, there's a off the stick, there's a pipe going through down. His costume down, and there's actually a seat he sits on.
Yes.
So, but it's very clever, you know, it's very clever. Anyway, yeah. but in saying that, you and I have lived a lot in the Himalayas, and we always would hear our Indian friends talk about how they saw a yogi levitating up in the Upper Mustang area or... Mm. In Himachal Pradesh, and you know, not just that. Like we've heard people say that there's 300-year-old yogis up in the caves, and that, and you know, we've been asked a few times to go there, but it never sort of eventuated. So, you get a lot of this in Himalayas, particularly, and maybe for good reason. There's a wonderful energy.
Yeah.
You know, probably the greatest power on the planet being in those mountains. So. Yeah. Anyway, so number five
is called a prapt. It means extension, mm-hmm. the ability to be anywhere, anytime, according to your will.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, bridging great distance, just like teleportation.
It is teleportation, this one, isn't it?
Yeah.
It is teleportation.
Yeah.
And in this one, it actually, the Yoga Bhashya suggests that the adept with this one can actually touch the moon.
Mm.
This is the level of the extension.
Yes.
That the yogi can experience, or the siddha can experience.
Mm-hmm.
They can actually touch the moon.
Yes.
You know, it sounds pretty wild, but that's what the idea of prapti is like. Mm-hmm. So, okay, number six, we got prakamya. And prakamya is irresistible will. So this is the ability to use your will freely and to kind of realize whatever desire you have.
Mm-hmm.
And the Yoga Bhashya actually says that we can dive into the solid earth as if it was liquid with this one. So,
right.
So it's kind of the mind over matter literal metaphor.
Right.
Like really mind over matter. I can turn this cup into a liquid or into a hammer, you know, like... Whatever, like, it, you know. Yeah. And this kind of relates to the one before, prapti, with extension, right? Like,
yes, yes.
Like, you'll see a lot of these overlay a little bit with each other.
Cause yeah.
The will is very important. And we know this with spiritual practice, and a lot of people would know this, that the more you actually practice your spiritual practice, the more acute your will actually becomes.
Mm.
And actually, it's an exercise in strengthening your will in some sense.
Yeah. Yeah, it's a good point. Yes, so number seven is Vashitva, means mastery. Yeah, mastery over the material elements to have control of the natural of the forces.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, so yep. Mastery over the material elements to manipulate material elements in nature.
Yeah, it's complete mastery over, right? And again, that relates to prakamya. The first one also relates to irresistible will, right?
Yeah.
Because you're having mastery over the over the elements.
Yeah.
But we're talking here the material elements.
Yes.
We're not really talking about the subtle forms here, right? But then we get into number eight, which is Ishitva, which is the perfect mastery over the subtle causes of the material world.
Mm.
So those two are related, right? So that's you can tell there's a stepped process there.
Mm.
First, you have control over the material.
Yes, yes.
Then you have control over the subtle...
Subtle energies.
Yes, that's right. So, and this one is like, with Ishitva, you have like supremacy over nature. So, in this sense, they would say in the scriptures that the adept or the siddha is on par with Brahma, the creative god or creative principle.
Yeah,
so,
right.
Mm. So, they would say that.
Yeah, so you tap into that subtle energies of nature. So.
Yeah, because you align with the creative principle, which you know is deified as Brahma, the creative god, and so you align with that creative principle, and then you're not creating universes, but you are tapping into and manipulating the subtle forces of the universe.
Mm.
And so we come to number nine.
Number nine is kama avashita. So it's the fulfillment of all desires or complete satisfaction.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so the unobstructed ability to will whatever into manifestation.
Yes.
Yeah.
And this is sometimes the eighth one, but we added in Garima, the infinite heavy. So this is kama avashita is usually number eight. But as we said, so, and this is related to Ishvara, right?
Yes.
This is related to Ishvara. And when we talk about Ishvara here, we're talking about either Shiva or Vishnu. Mm. Depends on, you know, if you're a Shaiva or a Vaishnava. But them being a representation of Brahman, the ultimate reality. So, yes, this is the fulfillment of all desires, isn't it? The complete satisfaction.
Yes.
A complete power.
Yeah, so just, as you mentioned, just what Brahman has, right? The power that Brahman contains, right?
Yes, that's right.
So
it's unobstructed will to manifest. But it cannot go against the will, so to speak, of Ishvara.
Oh, yeah.
So your will would be, well, if we're talking about Vedanta, all of our will is aligned with Ishvara. But,
yes.
But like... to split hairs here to explain this one, it's if you try to go against, say, the Tao, then you'll suffer the same fate as anyone who tries to go against that current.
Yep.
So, but again, it is unobstructed will to manifest whatever. Now, they are the great 8/9 magical powers, and that would be what we would call higher tantrism, right?
Mm.
So that the more noble path. But again, you can slip into problems with those when you start making a public display.
Yes. I mean, as you mentioned earlier about will, then your will becomes very important here, right? Mm-hmm. Your will cannot be something intentionally negative, right? That your will has to be pure and innocent. Not harming anyone, obviously, has to be for a really plausible reason why you exercising these powers, right?
Yes, yes. But that's why the masters say there shouldn't be a public display, and they should be, if accessed, used conservatively. It's not not something that, you know, we've seen public displays of this before, right?
Yes.
Not just within the Hindu tradition, but within the Taoist tradition.
Yeah.
We won't mention any names, but you guys can kind of understand who we're talking about. So now we come to the six black magical powers. So this is what you've probably all been waiting for. And a lot of people speculate as to what these powers are.
Yeah.
And we will speak about them in detail. And this is known in Sanskrit as Shatkarma. And there are only six as opposed to 8/9 of the great powers. And so... without further ado, let's begin.
Yeah, so the first one is called Shanti. We all know that means peace, So ability to pacify anyone by magical means through use of mantras, yantras, and visualization.
So this is the negative perspective of Shanti,
yes.
too, which you need to explain, because this isn't Shanti, 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 like in the great scriptures. This is Shanti in a negative perspective. The negative perspective of Shanti. So people can use that, as you said, to pacify people from a distance, so to speak, or pacify their minds, if you will. And so the second one is Vashikarana, which is subjugation. So this is the ability to bring people under your control, making them basically your subservient slaves. Sounds like the media. Sounds like the media, right? So... or sounds like a government.
Yes.
You know, they practice Vashikarana. That's what they do. The media, the government, it's actually a practice of black magic.
Yes. Using like a subtle manipulation, isn't it? Yes. Like there's words and visual.
Yeah.
With all these things.
Well, you bring people, you are bringing people under your control.
Mm.
You know, through what you said, words and visuals. And then we become the slaves of the system.
Right.
That's what they're doing, if you're not aware of it, you know. Mm. So,
okay, third one is called Stambana. So it means stoppage, ability to immobilize another being or make a situation ineffective.
Yes. So that's, yeah, you can basically, well, apparently, according to the literature, you can pause somebody from any part of the world.
Yes.
So you can put the pause button on them or make a situation ineffective. So yes. You can cause sort of turmoil in
certain situations.
Number four is ukatana. And ukatana means eradication. And this is the ability to destroy someone from a distance. So, and you don't have to see them with ukatana.
Yes.
You don't have to see them. You can influence their emotion. And you can also influence emotions between two peoples, which is similar to actually stambana, because you're affecting situations.
Yes.
But this is more intimately on a psychological level, where you're affecting the emotional states of two people, maybe in conversation.
Mm.
And so, yeah. So, you know, again, this, when you think about ukatana, you also think about like voodoo, right? The practice of voodoo.
Ah, yes. Except the doll.
Yeah. Except you don't have a doll in this case. It's more mental. Yeah. Okay.
So number five is called vidveshana. So this means causing dissension.
Mm.
Yeah, ability to create discord among groups of people, like instigating a certain situation between certain people and things like that.
That's right.
Mm.
Yeah, you can cause a riot. You can cause dissension between two nations or two groups of people.
Yeah.
Again, the media, the government are practicing vidvishana. They are.
Yep.
They really are. They're causing dissension.
Yes.
Except it's more of an open display.
Mm.
Theirs is not really subtle.
Nope.
So, and the last one is marana. Now, marana means technically causing death. So this means the ability to kill someone from a distance, which is, you know, a terrible power to have, but power that twisted people desire. And this can be useful for assassins, for example. It can be useful for assassins or anyone at war.
Mm.
So if you believe in this, right? So it can be useful for those sorts of people. So as you see with the last, particularly the last three or four, are kind of very similar, aren't they?
Mm.
The ability to like just cause chaos from a distance is basically what would, and it would even cause death from a distance,
yes,
if need be. So,
just to cause disharmony.
Basically. Yeah. And so, like I said, a modern representation of those black magical powers would be the media, governments, anyone who is in an authoritarian position, who are trying to dictate over the population.
Yeah, according to their agenda and desire.
Exactly.
Mm.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, that's what they're doing, right? They're influencing everyone according to their own agenda and desires.
Mm.
And so the thing is with these black magical powers, as opposed to the 8/9 great magical powers, is that these black magical powers, they fall short of the ideal of tantrism, which is liberation.
Mm.
That's the problem with them, right? And tantrism itself and liberation is encompassed by high moral values with Hindu moral values.
Yes.
And so that's where the black magical powers sort of fall out of a line with the tantric perspective, even though you could say the study of those are related to tantra. But they're not in alignment with liberation. They're in alignment with tyranny. They're in alignment with control, power.
Yes.
So now we've got to come to obviously when we talk about the black magical powers, we know why the spiritual masters would say that we should avoid siddhis, because the development of siddhis, even in some sense, if it's the spontaneous arising, if it's akopita, you can still be drawn into the black magical powers.
Right, yes.
But you can also be drawn into public displays of your magical powers. So, which what we would call peacock consciousness.
Yeah, it's just, for display, to show off, basically.
Yeah, like, look at what I can do.
Mm.
You know, I can put a pencil through a table. I can levitate. I can create fire with qi.
It's a lot of the posturing going into, isn't it? That they display themselves as a spiritual person who have these spiritual powers, but in the end, you're posturing your ability, right? So externalizing spirituality in the end.
Yeah, it is externalizing, and that's and what's that? It's ego driven.
Yes.
So that defeats the purpose of spirituality itself, particularly Eastern spirituality.
Yeah.
And that's one of the big problems. And a lot of people will support siddhis. They say, yeah, but that people who say that are just people who don't have siddhis. Mm-hmm. And it's like, well, that's not really what's being said because the masters said them. And I'm pretty sure some of the masters may have had some sort of experience with siddhis, because even siddhis, in some sense, which a lot of people probably have experienced personally, can be related to clairvoyance, can be related to an acute intuition.
Mm.
So, and usually what happens when you, particularly with meditators, when you begin to meditate long term, your intuition becomes very acute and attuned to kind of this energetic vibrational existence that we live within. And so it becomes attuned to that. But it's not like you don't openly display that. It's an experience you experience.
Yes.
And a lot of masters probably have had those sorts of experiences, because most of us probably have. But it's not like an open display, like levitating or something like this. Mm-hmm. Like it's, and so even they push it to the side and say, you've got to transcend it, because it's still related to being a peacock. You know, you're strutting around, you go and look at me, look at what I can do.
Yes.
But I've actually seen, we've been in the company of teachers who say, you know, siddhis are great. This is evidence of your level of spirituality.
Mm.
And maybe within tantric schools, that's, or within alchemical schools, that's really all well and good. But when you want to get into the higher states of consciousness, it's not all well and good, because you still haven't cleansed out the ego and the one who wants to display these powers.
Ultimately, the goal of our spiritual work is to go beyond siddhis, right?
Yeah.
Yes. Again, like this idea of siddhi exists in tantric school.
Mm.
And in tantrism, it affirms the phenomenal world so that it means your spiritual sadhana only exists under the umbrella of a physical world, a phenomenal world.
Mm.
Whereas a real work of self-transformation is to go beyond the ego, to go beyond the cities. So if you were to think that cities are like level of your spiritual mastery and this and that, that is just a full BS, because if your real goal is to go beyond, transcend the level of cities.
Yeah, and liberation isn't a city. So the ultimate goal of Eastern spirituality is complete liberation from your ego. So you merge with Brahman or Tao, Dharmakaya, what have you. And so that's not a siddhi. That's attained not by siddhis, but from sincere sadhana and practice. It can be spontaneous for some people, like Ramana Maharshi, or it can be lengthy for some other people. Mm. It depends on our aptitude as within our psychosomatic organism. And like I mentioned before with Varanasi, like even in the tantric schools, they mention siddhis in the sense of like landmarks or sort of goal signposts of your development within your sadhana, your spiritual practice, but they're not the end. Banaras Varanasi is the end. That's where the complete dissolution into Shiva happens. And so you don't want to stop at these goals.
Yes, exactly.
Signposts.
Yeah, signposts, yes.
So you got to keep moving along.
Exactly, yes.
And that's where, again, Vedanta comes in, right? Vedanta comes in. And I don't want to make this a thing between Vedanta versus Tantra at all. It's not. Just from this perspective, because Tantra has a lot of great elements within liberation as well. We're only speaking about one element here of siddhis. And siddhis, like I said, it's not isolated to Tantra. It's within the Shaiva tradition. It's within Taoism and Buddhism. You find knowledge of siddhis, but it's more thorough as what we've explained here within the Tantra tradition.
Yep. Yep.
But in the end of the day, even a Tantrika needs Vedanta. They need the knowledge of the of Brahman.
Yeah.
That's ultimate liberation, yeah. Right? So,
again, not completely putting negative meaning to the siddhis, the magical powers, but it's I think important to have a healthy distance from it. You acknowledging, let's say, if you feel that you have been developing these powers through your rigorous practice, right? That you just experience, you acknowledge what it is, but not to make it as a you are somebody to show off to other people and posture what you can do in front of people, right?
Yeah. Mm. Does it make you more spiritual than someone else?
No.
That's where like a hermit in the mountains would just laugh at those sorts of people because they are only at a certain level of development. And it's with they still within this individual egotistical mind body complex.
Yes.
And they're operating from that. That's still a very low level of development within the spiritual path.
Yes, yes.
So we have to, like you said, we have to transcend that, go beyond that to experience the ultimate. But in everything that we've been saying, there are these effects according to the scriptures.
Yes.
And so it's a matter of whether everyone listening and watching believes it or not. Mm. You know, it's entirely up to the individual.
Yes.
And so... It's not up for you and I to decide because that knowledge is there.
Right.
And so for those of you who are listening or watching, you know, please leave a comment and, and tell us if you've ever come across any of, if you've ever experienced a Siddhi or if you've seen any sort of public display of Siddhis. I mean, many of us have seen plenty of public displays, whether they are fake or not, particularly with manifestation.
Yes, yes. I mean, since the dawn of New Age movement, that we've seen a lot of people who claim themselves they're great channelers or, I don't know, having these amazing powers. But with a lot of those people, I felt a lot of, the fakeness about it. Like they were more interested in expectation from people, from acting a certain way, right?
Mm. Mm. They wanted adulation.
Yes.
They want adulation. Oh, look, I have superpowers. And so you don't really like, channeling, like we don't need to get started there, right? So, but channeling, you would say, is technically, would be called a siddhi.
Mm.
And like you said, since the dawn of the New Age movement, people have taken liberty with that sort of information.
Yes.
And so you have to be very intelligent and, you know, weed through the BS a little bit so you don't fall down into blind alleys, right? We've seen, there's been many popular gurus who have fooled people into this as well. Like it's not just your random New Age channeler. Like there's been popular, very popular, influential gurus who have exhibited siddhis and air quotes, but it's all been a show.
Mm.
And so... Mm. But we don't need to get into who they are or why they do it or their motivations. But we're just, Guyang and I are just saying that so you don't fall for any of these tricksters, charlatans.
Yeah.
So.
And also people misunderstand this idea of visualization and in tune with your intuition and things like that. Because, I mean, we've seen some documentaries saying that if you visualize, it'll happen. If you visualize you want to own a house or car or something like that, it'll happen in a certain amount of time and these kind of things. And they bridge this idea into spirituality, but that's not really true sense of spirituality. Oh, we all know that. That is just something, some sort of a material expectation from doing spiritual work, right?
Mm-hmm.
So that's something like we're trying to use the spiritual powers to attain something, attain some sort of material possession, which is kind of the same thing as the siddhis, the magical power, but which is, completely absurd.
Well, the whole law of attraction is driven by ego.
Yeah.
I want something. I want the house. I want the riches. That's the ego. That's not spirituality.
Mm.
That's one of the frustrating things that I've heard over the years when people mention to me or I hear mentioned, what are you into spirituality, like law of attraction and this and that? It's like, what did you say? Law of attraction in relation to spirituality. Interesting. No, I'm not into law of attraction. Plus, the law of attraction is a warped version of mental alchemy within Hermeticism and has been marketed by certain books, which we won't mention, for profit. And only the gullible fall for those.
Yes.
And look, law of attraction, technically you would fall, you might categorize that as a siddhi.
Mm.
But again, that's even an extreme ego-driven siddhi. 100%. It only strengthens and reinforces your ego. I want that house. I want that car. I want that lady. You know? And so off down the rabbit hole you go. But
yes.
We should, especially particularly on the Eastern spiritual path, we need to avoid all of those pitfalls and stay the course.
Yes.
And not fall for such traps. Mm. That's what the spiritual masters... The spiritual masters are concerned about everyone who follows a spiritual path because they've seen time and time again people fall for these tricks.
Yes.
And it diverts their focus from liberation.
I mean, like a lot of people get into the spiritual practice and they achieve certain level, let's say, like a certain level of concentration, attention, focus, attention, things like that. And yeah, through deep meditation, they may have visualized something and then really did happen, let's say, and they feel like that's something, some sort of achievement for them, right? And they take that as a too much of a achievement and goal to themselves, right? And we easily fall to that sort of trap. We're kind of trapping ourselves, right? We attain certain level of deep meditation, but then we use it in the end against ourselves, really.
Yeah. There's a lot of metaphors or a lot of analogies about people going to a sacred place for they're going to ultimate liberation, right? So say Bodh Gaya, right? The Bodhi tree. You're on your way to Bodh Gaya. You're on your way to the Bodhi tree. But then as you're going on the pilgrimage, you park up in Rajgir. You're in Rajgir. It's like, it's nice here. It's chill. You know, Vulture's Peak is there and not too far away. Nalanda's not too far away. And you set up a shop there. You're good. And that's what happens when you fall for siddhis.
Mm.
You're setting up a shop,
but
your purpose was to get to the Bodhi tree.
Right.
And you're like, this is good. Look, I created a wallet or I created a watch. I don't know that. And it's like, but it defeats the purpose. You've missed the whole point of why you're a cultivator, why you're on the path. So anyway, that's that, isn't it?
Yeah.
So guys, I hope you enjoyed and we'll see you guys next time.